Welcome to another segment of Crossroads. This afternoon, we're filming a presentation on the prehistoric Indians of Bartow County. This is the second program we've done on Native Americans. We filmed an earlier presentation on the Cherokees, and this program will focus primarily on the Etowah Indian mounds. The first half of this program will be shot on location here at the mounds. The second half of the program will be conducted with David Archer and myself throughout the county. At this point, I would like to introduce to my left Libby Bell, who is a site manager here at the Etowah Indian Mounds. And to her left is Tina Shadden, who is the interpretive ranger. Libby, I think it would be of interest to our audience if we indicated how the Indians came to North America. They, just like white people, they were not always natives to this country, and they came from somewhere else too. Would you give a brief description of what the prevailing theory is?
The prevailing theory is that they came across the Bering Strait into this continent, mm-hmm. and we believe with the latest archaeology, it was sometime between 40 to 50,000 years ago that they did come to this continent.
So have Native Americans been here in Bartow County for 50,000 years, or how does that work?
Well, through archaeology, we have discovered projectile points that date back to anywhere from 12 to 15,000 years ago. And some of the points that have been found in Bartow County are called Dalton points, mm-hmm. which are particular points used by the Paleo Indians.
Now, on this particular site here at the mounds, what's the oldest known artifact or?
Okay, in 1987, we did an archaeological survey of the East Village area, and we found a LaCroix point that dated to 6,000 BC.
Now, when people come to the mounds to see the culture that lived and fished and hunted and farmed on this area, what time frame are we talking about here?
The time frame for the Etowah mounds is somewhere around 900 AD to around 1540.
When this civilization flourished
here. When the people were here, and the peak occupation was around 1200 AD. Mm-hmm. There were about 2,000 to 3,000 people that lived in the village area here at that time, and they were utilizing the mounds.
I understand there was quite a large Indian city here at one time. What is it about this particular site that would have made it suitable or attractive to people to live here and be able to create an urban environment on this site?
Well, the physiographic region here, you're in a rich alluvial soil bottomland here, the Etowah Valley area, and they could grow their crops and utilize their stone hoes and their shell hoes. You had the river teeming with fish, and it was just a very good area for transportation too, so it was a rich area for crops and for protection mm-hmm. right here.
Is this site particularly unique? Is this the only place in America where you find mounds, or is this just one among many in the country?
It's one among many, and you'll find them mostly on rich bottomlands like the Etowah site, next to rivers.
Now, how extensive would this mound culture be in terms of throughout the United States, or?
Well, it's mainly in the southeast. You have mounds as far away as Wisconsin, Sparrow, Oklahoma, and even into Florida. So it's mainly in the southeast, and there are thousands of mounds, even on farmlands, which you'll see later.
Mm-hmm. Would this be a premier mound site here, or are there some that were even more elaborate than what we find here at Etowah?
I think there's one especially that's more elaborate, and it's in Illinois, along East St. Louis, right in that area, mm-hmm. and it's called Cahokia. That particular site covered around 5 square miles. There was a population of around 30 to 40,000. They had over 100 mounds, and the largest mound was 100 feet high, and it had a temple on top of it. So it was the most elaborate Mississippian culture site in the southeast.
When did people like the Smithsonian or other such organizations become interested in this mound site?
Well, there was a controversy over who in the world built these mounds. I mean, they did not even think that the American Indian was smart enough. They just felt like they were savages, and they were wanting to find out who built the mounds, where did they come from. there are several different theories of who they, you know, were particularly. But in 1883, the Smithsonian sent out a group of archaeologists, and John Rogan just happened to come to this particular site. I was reading some of the letters that he wrote back to Cyrus Thomas between 1883 and 1886 about the different mound sites in Bartow County and the one here and how he was describing it. And they did excavations in Mound C. They did test pits in Mound D and along the other village area. And he was talking about the erosion, especially from the river flooding periodically, leaving a lot of things exposed. Then in 1925 and 26 and 27, the winners of those months, Phillips Academy, Dr. Warren K. Moorhead came down, and he did excavations again in Mound C, did auger test in Mound B, and some other tests in the village area also.
So when people from Bartow County come out to this museum, and they make the assumption, which I would, that what they found, what you all have on display here is essentially all that's ever been located, and I gather from what you're saying is that when the Smithsonian and the other people came, that they probably carted out a large number of artifacts with them.
They surely did. There was, from what I remember, there was a gentleman's agreement between Warren K. Moorhead and Mr. Tumlin at that particular time, who owned the property, that if there was ever a museum built, that these items would return. Well, you know what gentleman's agreement is nowadays. And so, yes, this land was in private ownership at that time, and the artifacts that were discovered were taken back to the different localities.
I wonder if, what year did this become a state site and become protected from just general public from out here digging and plundering?
Right. In 1953, the Georgia Historical Commission purchased the Etowah site.
So up until that point, anybody from the community or the county or anywhere else could just come out here and dig if they wanted to, I guess.
Well, not really, because Mrs. Tumlin was pretty protective of the site. I know that a lot of people did come and find some things, but she was pretty protective of the site. It, even in Etowah papers I read where she would not let Dr. Warren K. Moorhead do any digs in Mound A because she said he didn't know enough about archaeology to do the digs there. So they pretty well protected the site.
Okay. That's interesting. Tina, what I would like to ask you is the procedure or the process that archaeologists use in determining how to locate this information and artifacts and material that have been located here at this site. Even I know that you don't bring a front-end loader or a bulldozer out and start moving dirt, that it's a little more complex than that. Comment on that for us, if you will.
Okay, what they try to do to begin with when a site is under study is they do lots of research to begin with, and that includes bringing in documents. For example, here they brought in the DeSoto documents from the expeditions in the 1500s, and that shed some light on it. And then other documents from the 1800s gave us an idea of how the mounds had progressed from 1500 up to 1800. And prior to all that, they map and survey the site. So you know exactly where, when you excavate, where things are found and located. So it's very precise, and they do a lot of work beforehand before they ever begin excavating, because excavating is your, like, the last resort. If you cannot answer questions any other way, then you excavate, and that's exactly what they did in excavating Mound C to find out more about the people who lived here and who built the mounds and occupied this area.
You know, I've been to a lot of museums in my life, and particularly I've always been intrigued with, you go into a museum and they say this was here in 1300. Well, Columbus wasn't here till 1492. Mm-hmm. Now, I always wondered, until I finally found out, how they could date all these artifacts that you find in museums such as mm-hmm. the one we have here at Etowah. Now, what I have in my hand here is a cow bone that Libby produced for me. And what, as I understand it, what archaeologists do, if they find fragments of bone buried in a site like the mounds, then they would surround it with Geiger counters. It's called a carbon 14 test. Mm-hmm. And this bone, in 5,600 years, half of it would be completely deteriorated. In exactly 5,600 more years, another one-fourth of it another 5,600 years, the final 1/4 of this bone would, in effect, disappear. And I understand with a very small margin of error that that's, that they can date things pretty accurately with the carbon-14 technique there. Now, at this point, I think it would be interesting if we went into the museum and looked at some of the items that have been retrieved from this site and further interpret the culture and the civilization that flourished here.
We have many display cases in the museum, but I feel that the display case that I'm standing in front of now gives a better overall view of what the site looked like back during the peak occupation of 1200 AD. This drawing was done by H. Tom Hall of National Geographic, and it appeared in the October 91 issue of National Geographic. As you look at the map here, you will see the village area with all of the little wattle and daub constructed houses. This is the large mound, Mound A, with the Temple to the Sun on top of it. Mound B, you would have probably had some type of structure on top of it also. Mound C was the burial mound, the only one excavated at the site. The large plaza in front of the large mound extended 300 feet out in a large rectangle, and this is where they had their ball games, their ceremonial gatherings, and their social gatherings. But you can see this area covers around 54 acres. You can see the palisade wall with the bastions or lookout towers where they would stand to make sure they would not be attacked by surprise. Beyond the palisade wall are the rich bottom lands where they grew their crops. The river, the Etowah River, you can see the fish trap in the river right behind Mound B. And then on the other side of the river, there was some type of occupation also.
According to excavations by John Rogan and Warren Moorhead, we do know there was occupation on the opposite side of the river from the Etowah site. Another feature of the site that has been excavated is the ditch area, and it was outside the palisade. And again, that was another mechanism to defend themselves from attack. There is a portion of the ditch still evident today, but on the map here, of course, it's all drawn out because this is how the village would have appeared from the air probably about 1200 AD.
The Mississippian culture extended at a wide range in the southeast. We've drawn a map up here to show you of the United States, and you can see the extensiveness of the Mississippian culture. It extended to Wisconsin, all the way to Spiro, Oklahoma, all the way to the tip of Florida. And what characterized this Mississippian culture was the building of large flat-top ceremonial mounds, not only burial mounds, but as was in an earlier culture, but in this particular culture, it was also ceremonial mounds. At the Etowah site, we have one of the largest ceremonial mounds in the southeast.
During the Mississippian period, the Indian people were not arranged in tribes. They were arranged in a chiefdom. And according to the map here, this gives you some of the chiefdoms that were located in North Georgia, Lower Tennessee, and then in Alabama along the river valleys. Of course, here is Etowah, the site that we are dealing with. And you notice that there are little clusters. There are several villages in an area of the river valley. So Etowah was the capital or the central city in this chiefdom in the Etowah River Valley. And, of course, this would be the Coosa chiefdom. And, of course, the others are labeled Hiawassee, Little Tennessee. But these are all chiefdoms with a central village and then smaller outlying villages. And the people in those villages did owe their allegiance to the chief who would be in the central city. Okay, these are the world-famous marble statues from Etowah Mounds. We have people every year who visit our site from all over the world just to see the statues. And generally, they always say that it's worth the visit just to see the statues. They are from the site. The marble has been analyzed and determined that it was from Tate, Georgia. So it was from within the state. We're not exactly sure if they brought the marble here and then carved the statues. That is what is generally believed. Mm-hmm. And they weigh about 125 pounds each, and of course, one is a male and the other one is a female.
Okay, these two statues were found in Mound C. They were found in the last dated grave there in Mound C. They were broken when they were found, and I'll tell you a little story about it. Dr. Lewis Larson had a crew from out doing the excavations, and one of the guys, one of the workers, was down there, and he was troweling away, and all of a sudden he saw this red painted ear. So he ran to Dr. Larson, and he said, "Dr. Larson, I have found a red painted ear." Well, you know, Dr. Larson goes running over to the grave, and sure enough, you could see the red painted ear of one of the statues. So they trailed it away. This was 1954 when they did this excavation and found the statues. And they carried these heavy statues away from the site in a wheelbarrow. They weighed so much. But they are very unique. They were found broken. And there's two reasons why, you know, we think they may have been broken. One is they were in a hurry when they were burying the statues, and they accidentally dropped one in on top of the other and broke them. And the other explanation is these Native Americans believed everything had a spirit. So they thought that, you know, maybe if they kill the object, in other words, they would break it to kill it, this would release the spirit for them to go to the next life with these people. In DeSoto's journals, they talk about statues like this, and when they went through the southeast, they would see wooden statues standing in the temples with the important person, like the chief or the chiefess. So they felt like, well, maybe they were carved to look like the chief and chiefess, placed in the funeral temple, and at the death of the chief and chiefess, their spirits were housed in these objects. And these objects were venerated just as much as the chief and chiefess were when they were alive, and even the bones of the remains were venerated very highly because they felt like they still had a type of power about them. So again, these are very unique and very special to the Native Americans.
This is another drawing that came from the National Geographic article from October 91, and this gives you a view of the village. We believe from the excavations, this is how the huts would have been constructed. The wattle and daub, the wattle being, there would have been a stick structure underneath, and then the daub is the clay that would cover the outside there, and then thatching for the roof. Of course, you see the people in the village here, a lot of different activities going on. This is probably very close to the way it would have looked because there would have been many activities going on. Very few people would have been in their houses. They did most of their living outdoors. You see them preparing acorns here, grinding the acorns into meal that they would have used to make a bread. You know, the lady with her child, this fellow is taking corn out of the corn crib. It would have been dried and preserved by being kept in the corn crib. And then, of course, in the background, you see the ever-present mounds with the temples on top of them.
The only thing, she's pointed out everything great. The only thing that I would like to add is you can see in the background, like she said, the mounds, but you notice there are no trees or grass on the mounds. As they would build the mounds up, they would build a layer at the time. They would start off with maybe a layer 6 feet high, build the temple on top, and at the death of the chief, they would burn that house and add another layer of dirt. So really, not a lot of grass or trees had time to grow because they were continually adding dirt to the mound.
Maybe that was a very informative presentation that you and Tina did inside the museum. And now we're back in front of the museum here and looking at the mounds and river in the background. And I can't help but wonder, with all the rapid urbanization and the influx of people and subdivisions and so on and so forth, what will happen to this site out here as time progresses. I think everybody in Bartow County is becoming more aware of the encroachment upon famous or historic sites here in the county, and I'm sure that you've been out here for several years, as I know, and I'm convinced that that you would have some ideas on this topic. How many acres do we have on this site as it stands right now?
Right now, we have 69 acres. There's only 54 acres within the ditch area. That's the village and the mounds themselves. We do not have the complete site. We have most of it, most of the village area and the ditch, but we do not have the complete site.
Well, you can't help but stand here and look around, and if you could visualize subdivisions out in these fields and apartment units or commercial buildings, that it would be a major distraction to the site here.
Right. Like you say, I've been here for several years, and I have seen subdivisions coming in across the river, just beyond the tree line subdivisions, and churches being built and schools. And yes, we're definitely concerned about the growing population coming out this way. And I would love to have a buffer around the site so we could protect the integrity, we could get the entire site, so when people come here, they can still come out to view the flowers, the wildlife, because we have deer out here, we have turkey that come through, Canadian geese, we have a lot of different wildlife that comes here. And we just like to protect the integrity of the site, keep it beautiful, and so people can come here and just kind of get away from it all and view the site as the Indians had it.
Well, I can appreciate that after spending the afternoon out here.
Yeah.
Libby, thanks so much for allowing us to come out here and participating with you and Tina to give us the most informative program. Stay with us, and we'll be right back with David Archer for the second segment of this program.
Community has a dynamic and interesting history. Young Brothers Pharmacy is very much a part of that history, filling prescriptions with integrity for over 100 years. As times have changed, so has Young Brothers, offering up-to-date services for their customers, including hospital beds, wheelchairs, and other items for homebound patients. Today at Young Brothers, we're well into our second 100 years of serving the health care needs of Bartow County.
Welcome back to Crossroads. With me today is David Archer, who's been on a previous program with us. And Dave and I are going to have a discussion about the prehistoric Indians in Bartow County.
JB, I know in the earlier segment, what you primarily talked about was and focused on was the Etowah Indian Mounds. And although I've looked at the Etowah Indian Mounds and taken sort of a literary search to determine what literature, what studies, and reports from archaeologists, studies have been on file mostly in government depositories. I've also taken it beyond that and tried to locate and determine what resource material there is and what sites are available out around Bartow County as to other prehistoric Indian sites. And so what I wanted to discuss with you primarily is take it from a context of the periods in history that we're talking about, and then take it to the specific sites and discuss some of those specific sites. And you know, one thing I guess I need to say to begin with is what got me interested in this, other than that it's been somewhat of a hobby for a number of years, is that I must have read and reread Lucy Cunyath's Bartow County history a dozen times, at least in segments. And it occurred to me that in that book, which is probably better than any history on a county in the state, it really only has one chapter about our Indian prehistory, I like to call it. And it primarily focuses on Cherokees. And as we've discussed before, the Cherokees left in 1838. So what I've been focusing on is what happened before that. Do we have a history before 1838? Do we have a history before the Cherokee Indians? And the answer to that is yes, and that's kind of what I think we can focus on a little bit today. To begin with, the Etowah Indian Mounds. There are now three mounds that remain, but at one time there were seven mounds. The earliest report that I found that document that was a study, an observation and a report written in 1819 by Reverend Cornelius that was published and then republished in the 1850s, where he talked about actually visiting the Indian Mounds. and wrote about his experience and what he observed. So what I've looked at and what I think I can show you are some sites where at least as late as 1936, there was still evidence of 26 mounds that were located in Bartow County. Now, of those 26, there are three left. They had winding mounds, but there were 26. And there were a number of other significant sites that I think I can show you where they are and what reports I found and documented. But I think the significant thing about that is that it goes all the way back, there are sites in this county that go all the way back to at least 10,000 BC, 12,000 years ago.
You know, that's an interesting observation because when I was in college in covered wagon days, all the textbooks indicated that the earliest Indians in America, in North America, was about 25,000 years ago. And in the last 30 years, through better research techniques and what have you, they've moved that back to at least 40,000 years ago. So in this particular county, they've located Indian artifacts that could go back at least 10,000 years. Is that?
Well, you know, I say 10,000 years because the literature that I read dated at the time that information was written, and this was, I think, from a study in 1987. That report said 10,000 years, but you may have seen, and some of the audience may have seen the article in the Atlanta Journal about 3 months ago, where apparently archaeologists and historians are now saying that instead of earliest human occupation in this continent being 10,000 BC, that they now say it is more like maybe 25,000 BC. Now, the sites that have been located in Bartow County that date back to the earliest known human occupation, or what they call the Paleo-Indian phase, at the time they were doing that study, they thought 10,000. Now they think 25,000 BC. But I think it's significant that Bartow County is extremely unique in having just a very, very rich archaeological resource. And that's evidenced by the fact that this county has the largest land mass that is on the National Register of Historic Places, designated by the United States government. And it consists of 13,000 acres. It starts at the Alatina Dam. It follows the Etowah River all the way to the Floyd County line, and is like 2,000 feet on each side of the river, I believe. Maybe 1,000, I think it's 2,000. And then as to each major tributary, for instance, Pumpkin Vine Creek, coming into the river, it goes way up that creek. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people probably live on land that is on the National Register and don't even know it. That does not include the houses that they may live in on that land. It's just the land that is on it. And the reason for that, and how it ties in with this Paleo-Indian artifact discovery in this county, is that apparently in northwest Georgia, the only Paleo-Indian artifacts, ones that go back 10 to 25,000 BC, are in Cherokee County, Bartow County, and Floyd County, following the Etowah River, where it runs into the Coosa and on down the Coosa. That sort of dispels what I once thought, that our history starts in this county at 1838, when the Cherokees left and the white folks moved in, and all of our history books really are dated that. We go back much further than that.
Yeah, that's kind of fascinating when we focus on the last 160 years as being the only thing that was worthwhile to record that ever happened here, whereas in reality, as you say, you've had people living here continually for approximately 10,000 years. I think that's a good point to make.
I mean, if we can put on the screen the little cultural chronology of the Alatoona region, and while the viewers are looking at that, let me walk through it a little bit. The top of the screen where it says Paleo-Indian 10,000 to 7,800 BC, That now is corrected by archaeologists and historians who say it's more like 25,000 BC. We have walking now, if you start with that Paleo-Indian phase, and then you go down the list, beginning with the early Archaic, and then out beside it, you see the period of time that that involves. Now, skip all the way down to where it has, where you see late Mississippian, and it says 1350 AD to 1540 AD. That's the last phase, the last period of time that archaeologists now believe that there was occupation still at the Etowah Indian Mounds. Everything before that occurred prior to the evacuation of the Etowah Indian Mounds. And everything that occurs, that's shown on that list before that, there was human occupation in Bartow County. And some of the sites we're going to look at, we'll talk about whether it was the early woodland period or the archaic period, and that's what we're talking about. And I also think it's important to note, if you look out in the right-hand column, under the word phase, it has a number of phases in a column. You look down to middle woodland, and out beside 200 to 600 AD is the word Cartersville, and I kind of want to explain what that means. The way archaeologists determine what period of time an archaeological site is dated is by the type of pottery, the type of artifacts that are discovered at that site. Mm-hmm. Now, for the middle woodland period, and this is not just for this area, but internationally, when you want to talk about American Indians, American human occupation during the 200 to 600 AD middle woodland period, the type of pottery that has been dated at that time is called Cartersville, and it has a particular design, a particular stamp that was made specifically as to that pottery. And if you go up to the next early woodland period, you see Kellogg and post-Kellogg phase. Those are both sites that the result from a discovery at Kellogg Creek, where it runs into Lake Allatoona, of an early woodland village, and the particular type of pottery that they had at that village is called Kellogg and post-Kellogg pottery. And also, if you'll see Stamp Creek, Etowah, and Galt, all are names that come from this county that, to me, just indicates the rich archaeological resource.
Now, there is a document called the Historic Resources of Bartow County, which covers a lot of things other than Indian history. But in that segment of the historic resources in this county, it points out that there are between 500 and 600 distinct Indian sites in this county where they've located items of major interest, where Indian settlements and, as you say, pottery and other artifacts have been found. So it's one of the richest counties in the whole state, you know, with reference to Indian habitation and discernible sites that archaeologists have located in the last 150 years or so.
Let's walk through some of these sites, most of which we're going to talk about don't exist anymore. And the only reason we know about these sites that we're going to talk about is because somebody took the time many years ago, as early as 1819 and coming forward, to actually observe, excavate, report, document, and report. And what we have as a source to establish these sites are those reports, those written reports. On the screen now is a map of a segment of Bartow County, which has at the top of the screen the city of Cartersville as it existed in 1936. This map was done pursuant to a WPA study in 1936. It actually lasted about 4 years, but it concluded in 1936 by an archaeologist who headed up the study was Robert Wauchope, who did a report. He didn't actually do his report until 1964, so some of his stuff may not be too accurate. I don't know why he waited so long to do it, but it's a good thing that he did this report and this archaeological study, because it tells us about a lot of things that we just would not know about if it weren't for his study. One of those is on top of Ladd's Mountain. I know you and I have talked about the fact that many years ago, apparently as late as the 1930s, there was still a very large grouping of rocks in a circular formation that was on top of Ladd's Mountain. You've been to the Fort Mountain
in
Chatsworth. Mm-hmm. Any of you that have seen that, apparently what is on top of Fort Mountain has been studied for years by archaeologists. They have no idea what it is. They have a lot of speculation. They're not even sure the period, but apparently there was a similar formation of rocks on top of Ladd's Mountain. And in 1883, there was a Smithsonian Institute representative came and studied what was there and did a report on it, and he did a diagram. And if we can show you this diagram on the screen now. This diagram that you're looking at, if you can see the circular, about the third, let's see, the third ring from the outer ring, that was a formation of rocks with openings that are indicated by the letter B. And those openings range from about 10 to 60 feet. And according to this particular diagram that was done in 1883, there was another grouping of rocks at the very top of Ladd's Mountain. And so what happened to it? What was it? Why was it there, and what happened to it? And some years back, some of you may remember Francis Adair. I heard that Francis Adair had seen this rock formation when she was a child. And I think Francis died 4 or 5 years ago. But I called Francis and asked her what she knew about it and if she did remember it. And, you know, Francis was in her late 80s, 90s. I mean, she was very, you know, very elderly at the time, but had a memory that dated back to the very earliest years. And so, yeah, she remembered it, and she said that her father had taken her up on top of Ladd's Mountain, and she had seen it when she was a little girl. And she described it basically as what the diagram shows, and I asked her what happened to it. And so Francis told me that in the 1930s, when they paved West Avenue, when the city paved West Avenue and out Highway 61, that the city had gone up and gotten the rocks off the mountain and crushed them and used them to actually pave the highway. Well, I thought that was interesting. I thought it was funny. Some years later, after Francis had died, I was at a Rotary Club meeting giving a talk about some of these sites. And John Dent, who is former mayor of Carterville, and is a former city manager of Carterville, people may not remember, but in the 1930s, John Dent was city manager of the city of Carterville. And I told that story about Francis. And John Dent, after the meeting, came up and told me that indeed they hadn't taken the rocks off the mountain, that the city, and he apparently was in charge of the negotiations and facilitating getting the rocks, that the city had gone up and had bought the rocks from F.H. Shaw, who owned the property. I think John even told me that they paid a nickel a ton for the rocks. They brought them down the mountain, built a road up the back of it, brought them down the mountain, crushed them, and paved the road for them.
You know, to me, I know the story, but it's still phenomenal to me that there was something comparable to Fort Mountain right here at the outskirts of Cartersville, and that the remains of it we drive over today out on the Dallas Highway.
Yeah, well, that's another site is on the Dallas Highway. If you come on out, see if I can visually describe it. If you're going out Highway 61, you go past Ladd's on your right, Ladd's Farm Supplies on your right. You're going out a little bit, and you cross the river bridge, the Etowah River Bridge, and you're headed toward, like, Dallas or Rockmart. Mm-hmm. All right, just as you cross the bridge, bat your eyes because you just went over what was an Indian mound. Robert Wachow, in his study, wrote what was there in 1936, and he says that there were actually three mounds that were located at just as you cross the bridge, you're crossing one of them. Then there was one that was to your right that was closer to the river, and then he says there was a third one that was about a quarter of a mile downstream from those two, which downstream would be west from where the highway bridge is, about a quarter of a mile west down the river. Hmm. There was a third site, and what he says in 1936 and in his study is that that mound one, as he refers to it, is on the highway at the time of our visit. The edge of it had been cut away by the highway right-of-way. Mound two is a larger and steeper mound, about 18 feet high, lying closer to the river. Mound three is about a quarter of a mile downstream from those two. And he had quoted, the way he found out about them being there was a study, again, a Smithsonian study that had been done in 1894, where they were described by a fellow named Cyrus Thomas that wrote an article and did a report. So there's three of them right there. That's three of the 26 mounds that were in this county, that only three that are at the Etowah mounds are left.
Well, you know, when you kind of think about it, you got the three mounds that are still in existence here and protected by the state. But then when you begin to look around the immediate area, for example, Ladd's Mountain, I understand that around the turn of this century when they were dynamiting Ladd's Mountain for mining purposes, that when they exploded the charge, it opened up a cave and they found a treasure trove of Indian artifacts, prehistoric Indian artifacts in this cave, which obviously ended up somewhere in Bartow County.
Yeah, you know, you and I have talked about that a good bit, is looking at all these various archaeological reports and studies that have been done, and reading, I mean, this one I've got here, the WPA study in 1936, just documents artifact after artifact after artifact that was located, dug up, moved from this county to somewhere else. Where are they? Who's got them? Most of them, a lot of them, are at the Smithsonian Institute.
Well, I was going through the old newspapers up in the courthouse recently, and I found an interesting article about the Phillips Academy of Andover, Massachusetts did a major dig here.
In the 1890s.
And they took, the article pointed out that they took 3,000 artifacts out of this county back to Massachusetts. So Bartow County is, you know, it's rich in Indian relics and artifacts, but you see very, other than what we see at the museum here, you see very little evidence of it. It's all scattered across the country.
Well, JB, I think you ought to be in charge of going to Andover and and going to the Smithsonian and knocking on somebody's door and say, I come to get our artifacts and bring them back to this county.
Well, actually, I had a conversation with a gentleman named Dr. Dwayne King. He's quite famous in this country in Cherokee Indian history. And he's the assistant superintendent of the American Indian Museum, which is going to open in New York City. I talked to him about this, and he gave me some people to contact who would be knowledgeable about at the Smithsonian and a couple of other places that are major repositories of Indian artifacts, who have also done digs and studies here to see if we can find out what they've got and catalog it and at least have that knowledge if we can never get them back.
Well, it'd be neat to know where you could go and look at our artifacts at
right.
least, wouldn't it? Another site that talking about Ladd's Mountain for one more minute. In addition to that rock formation, in 1883, the Smithsonian investigator, archaeologist named Whittlesley, did a find and wrote a report about a large pile of rocks that was apparently just to the south, I think, yeah, to the south of the top of the peak of Ladd's Mountain. There apparently was a large pile of rocks that he said in 1883 had been disturbed greatly by people that were looking for lost Indian treasure, they thought. And they had gone in, it's about 20 feet high, and they had thrown rocks over to one side and the other. But out of that rock pile, he found a number of artifacts. I was speaking with Lewis Larson, who is a state archaeologist and is an anthropology professor at West Georgia College, who used to live here and did one of the studies at the Etowah Indian Mound. And he told me about going to that rock pile with Mr. F.H. Shaw, who owned the land that it was on sometime in the 50s, and that Mr. Shaw showed him some artifacts that he had actually found. One was a large copper ceremonial battle axe, and another was a copper face mask that he had actually found in that big pile of rocks. Hmm. Well, that big pile of rocks was gone too, but that's just another one of the sites that was here that we can read about, but we can't see anymore.
Well, I understand, and I haven't been up there, but I understand that there are still some of these, that the city didn't get all the rocks to crush them up, that there's still some of these rocks in this Fort Mountain-type formation yeah. still up there.
The only body that's told me that is totally unreliable, and that's Joe Tilley. Just recently, I was talking to Joe Tilley about this, and he said that you could go up there and see some of those rocks today, and I'd have to see it to believe it, but there may be. Another site of mounds, two mounds, that is no longer there, let me visually describe it for you, verbally describe it. If you go out Pine Grove Road, you're going south, you go past Dellinger Park, and you go on out until Pine Grove Road dead ends into Alabama Road. All right, and if we can put a diagram up for a minute, you can see. Let me see if I can find this. You can see the line running south from the city of Carterville and crossing the river, taking a little turn right as it crosses the river, and then dead ends into Alabama Road. And there's a little circle just before you cross the river that says BR7, that's Bartow County Site 7. And then on the south side, right as it enters, as the road, Pine Grove Road intersects with Alabama Road, there's a little circle that says BR6. Now, BR6 and BR7, as shown on that map, at least in 1936, were still mounds that were located. One, the one on the north side of the river, was about 100 feet from the north bank of the river. And as it appears on that map, Pine Grove Road runs right over the top of it. So apparently that mound, the dirt from that mound, was used to build that road right away. Now, the one across the river on the south side, I hate to upset anybody, but apparently there's a house built right on top of where that mound was. There's a subdivision right as you dead end into Alabama Road on the west side, on the right side, if you're going south. And apparently some of those houses in there are built on top of what was an Indian village site and also an Indian mound site. Mm. Now, if you come on down Alabama Road, head east on Alabama Road, there's a little field road that runs back over, runs north, and where you come out right across the Etowah River from the Etowah Indian mound site, right at where Pumpkin Vine Creek comes in to the river. Now, on both sides of Pumpkin Vine Creek, where it joins the river, were very significant sites that were studied in the 1890s, again by the Smithsonian, and again also in the 1930s, it was studied at least twice. Now, on the east side of where Pumpkin Vine Creek comes into the river, there was a large village site, and it dates back to the early woodland period and the late archaic period. Now, on the west side of Pumpkin Vine Creek, where it joins the river, there was another village and there was another mound. So that would be another of the 26 mounds, of which there are only three left. Now, on down Alabama Road, there was another site that's located on Puckett Road, where you crossed a little iron bridge. Right in that area, there was a large Indian village, and there was a mound. Some people say there's one still standing down there, but I never have seen it. If you go out Highway 61, like you're going to Dallas, or actually, like you're going to Rockmart, you don't turn and go to Dallas. You turn on Brown Farm Road, and it loops back around to Highway 61. Well, back over in there, where the railroad track runs along, follows the course of the river, right at the point where the railroad comes the closest to the river, it's actually, it's not on the Brown property, but it's, I don't know if I would say whose property it's on. It may be raided. I'll say it anyway. It's on Jake Kellen's property. Don't anybody go dig it up, but there was, I think it's gone anyway, but there was a mound there that was still there in 1936 when Mr. Wauchope did his study.
Well, David, you know, there's 26 mounds that's been identified by previous authorities and decades gone by, 1930s, 1880s, whenever. But I keep wondering if they located all of them, or those are just the ones that, in other words, could there have possibly been more than 26?
I think there were. The 26 I'm talking about are 26 that I have read about where an archaeologist at some point in time, whether it be 1890 or 1936 or whenever, they've written about it actually being there. They saw it, they observed it, they, in most instances, diagrammed it and have a little little drawing of what it was like. But yeah, I think there are a lot more that nobody has studied. All these studies are done by somebody that's got a budget, and their budget runs out, and so they don't find everything. I had somebody tell me within the last 2 weeks of a particular site that he is just absolutely certain is a mound. And from what he described as to its location, the type of land that it's around, it would be consistent with where mounds would have been built. You know, they like the river bottoms. And I've always wondered if those mounds didn't have something to do with flood control. I mean, I've never read that.
Well, I have neither, and that's strange you brought that up, because I've wondered before they built Allatoona Dam and the other dams to arrest floods.
The river flooded often.
And it would have certainly, where we are right now at the mounds, this would have all been underwater. And I think that's a novel idea.
Good question. Maybe too oversimplified. I've never heard any archaeologists say that was what it was for, but it makes sense to me. They're flat on top. They flood it all the time. You know, the river gets out of its banks. It's just obvious to me that they went on top of the mound. Well, I mean, they didn't swim around when they could have gone on top of the mound. It may not have been the purpose for which they were built, but it had to be at least an incidental usage of it. Let me put it that way. Another site that I've that's really intrigued me, if we can show a map on the screen now that if the viewers can focus on the center up at the top where it says proposed dam, and it has a little cup shape across the river. This map was done in 1936, again by Robert Wauchope, and the proposed dam site, of course, Allatoona Dam was not completed until 1950, I think, is when they actually flooded the lake, so it was completed sometime in the late 40s. So in 1936, when Robert Wauchope was in Bartow County doing this study with the WPA crew, that was in its original state where the Allatoona Dam is now. Mm-hmm. But there were plans even that early to build a dam. And what's interesting, if you look on the south of what is the river coming from the dam running west, he's got two circles, and by one circle he's got BR-45, and by the other circle, the one on the west side, he's got BR-44. What Wauchope said is that as to the one that he's got labeled BR-44, that there were three mounds located there. Now, as we know it today, this would be on the south side of the river on the access road that runs over beneath the dam, where there's a Corps of Engineers recreation park.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Now, what Wauchope said in 1936, that on the south side of the river, there were actually six mounds. Three of them were located at the circle that he shows as BR-44, and three of them were located at the circle that he shows as BR-45, but they were two separate and distinct sites. And he dated those back to the very early periods of the woodlands, with like late B.C., early A.D. And he says about the ones on the west, the three on the west, he says, these are in his words. Actually, wait a minute, he didn't write this. This is what a guy named Thomas in 1894 wrote, that Wauchope reprinted, about those three mounds. It says, the group consists of three mounds and a cemetery. The larger is somewhat irregular in form, the longer diameter, 150 feet, the shorter, 140, the whole height, 20 feet, but the height of the artificial portion, 15 feet, rounded on the top. One half of this was dug away, but finding neither specimens nor skeletons, no further investigations were made. He went on downstream a little bit and dug again, and he did find a number of grave sites. There was a cemetery in there. I don't know exactly whose land that would be on today, but I know they're not there anymore. And I don't know if any of these would have been on Corps of Engineers property or on private ownership or whatever. But I do know that I've gone down there and looked for these six mounds that were apparently located somewhere beneath the dam on the south side of the river, and they're not there. Now, what happened to them is the same thing happened to all the rest of them, I guess. They probably dug them up and used them for road right-of-way, or they were flattened and leveled and used for agricultural purposes. But at least whenever Wauchope studied in 1936, they were still there.
Which hasn't been, in a time frame, it hasn't been too terribly long ago.
No, it hadn't. Now another map that I want to show, that is a map of 1755 that shows this is not separated by Bartow County, but looking at that map, you can see up in the top middle portion, where it says Village of Pine Log, and then a little bit below that, where Two Run Creek runs into the Etowah River, it shows the Village of Two Run. Mm-hmm. Now, in 1755, now that's about the time that the Cherokees moved into this area. They hadn't been here very long at that time, but that's about the time they moved in. And apparently they weren't in Bartow County, but two major significant Indian villages. And one of them was the Village of Pine Log, and one of them was the Village of Two Run. Pine Log, you and I, JB, have spent some time trying to figure out exactly where it was, but we know that it was not actually at what we now know as Pine Log.
That's right.
It was over between the existing Pine Log on 411 and between there and Waleska, which is on out east on Highway 140, and there's a site that you and I both think we know exactly where it is.
I've had one of the older residents of the county drive me out there, and his family has been here since the early history of the county, and he showed me the site which had always been instructed to him was the Indian Village of Pine Log, and he also had a written description of it. And the site exactly squares with the written description by an early observer who had been there. So I feel fairly confident that I do know where that site is.
I think that site, the Pine Log site, although it was a village site in 1755, it had been a village site for, you know, eons before that. Mm-hmm. And you can take any of these village sites, and you may find evidence of occupation in the 1700s, 1600s, 1500s, and then go all the way back, in some instances, to 10,000 B.C., because the sites, if they look good to somebody in 1700, they probably look good to somebody in 10,000 B.C., so they just kept living on top of each other, you know, on top of where someone else had lived.
Right.
And all of these sites, in essence, that we've been talking about no longer exist, except on paper and in our minds. Now, that in some, we touched on some of the sites it would take a lot more time to cover all of them, but I think that's about all we've got time
for. Well, I think that's a fair representation. You know, I lived here for years and pretty much assumed that the only thing that that there was to see was the Etowah Indian Mounds. And I had no reason not to believe that there was anything else in the county. And then I run across a little bit of this at different times, and you and I have been talking Indian history, Cherokee, and prehistoric, and of course you've got a major interest in this, where mine was just a passing interest. But I think this is quite a revelation to a lot of people of how rich this county is. It certainly was to me when I first began to, along with you, unravel the magnitude of what's here.
Well, I've enjoyed you and I going out stomping in the woods looking for something.
We have had a good time.
I don't like to do it in the summertime because I'm scared of snakes, but in the fall and in the winter, it's fine.
And we'll do it again this winter. Well, David, thanks again for enlightening. And so, much of this I knew, a lot of it I didn't know. So on behalf of the audience and Channel 4 and Crossroads, thanks for being our guest today.
Thanks for having me, JB.
Mm-hmm. We'll be right back.